Hello friends, welcome to the world of project management and for a overview session on scope management. Motto of this training is to share my experience in preparing for PMP certification and prepared few slides. Let's start with my introduction. I'm Anil Kumar Dharam, based in the city of Nizams, Hyderabad, working in IT for 14 years and currently working as a project lead and manager from last 4 years. I succeeded in my certification in the same year 2019 and supporting 2 major projects currently and giving trainings on the SAP and project management. Let's quickly move to our agenda for today's session that we are going to discuss on scope management, predictive and agile project life cycles in terms and respect to scope management and the main 6 processes in scope management. The scope management consisting of the plan scope management, collect requirements, define scope, create workbench structure, validate scope and control scope. Before starting with the agile or predictive life cycles in terms of scope, I will explain about the keywords which are very important in the scope management. What is scope? Workbench structure, that is WBS, goal plating, scope management process. First is scope. In simple words, scope is process of defining what work is required and then make sure of that work and only that work is done. It's an simple in simple way. Coming to the WBS, that is work breakdown structure, this tool enables you to clarify, identify scope as well as find the additional scope. So in this, the requirements must be evaluated against the business case, ranked and prioritized to determine what is in and what is out of the scope. So moving to goal plating, it means intentionally adding the extra features or functions to the products which are not included in the scope statement. Scope changes should not be approved if they relate to work that does not fit within the project charter. So that's why so PMI doesn't suggest or support the goal plating. So this is about the scope, workbench structure and the goal plating. And at last, we'll discuss about the scope management process. Let me explain in the best 6 steps how the scope management process flows. Develop a plan for who you will plan, validate and control scope and requirements on the project. This is the first step. Coming to the second step, determine requirements. Make sure all the requirements support the project, that is business case, as described in the project charter. Moving to the third step, sort and balance the needs of stakeholders to determine the scope. Coming to the fourth step, create the work-based structure to break down the scope down to smaller parts, more manageable pieces, and define each piece in the work-based structure dictionary. Fifth step, obtain validation that the completed scope of work is acceptable to the customer or sponsor. And the last step, measure the scope performance and adjust as needed. In the real world, the requirements team will be different and the scope we work on determining the requirements are different. You must be able to say no when someone tries to add unnecessary scope to your project. It adds time, cost and risk to the current project that is not at all required. Need to say as it falls under a separate project and need to go with the project approval process and so on. This is about the scope management process flow. And last, we are going to discuss on product and project scope. Product scope. This is mean the end results. Example, a new airport terminal that meets all the technical specifications compared to the product requirements. Project scope. Delivers the product of the scope. Example, a new airport terminal that meets all the technical specifications plus all the work needed to be delivered the terminal. Project scope includes planning, coordination and management activities that ensure the product scope is achieved. So hope you understand the keywords. Let's move to the agile and predictive life cycle in terms of scope. In predictive life cycle, as I say, the scope baseline is already defined and go with the monitoring and controlling of the activities. Where in agile and adaptive life cycles, for each iteration, planning and monitoring is set. For each iteration provides a feedback which helps for the next iteration in terms of product backlogs. So we have covered the basic introduction of the scope management and its keywords and the scope management processes. In the next video, we are going to discuss in detail about each scope management process, starting from plan scope management and ending with the control scope. Thank you. Welcome friends. I'm Anil Kumar Dharam, explaining you the planned scope management process and scope management knowledge area in this video. As continuing with the previous video, where I gave a brief introduction to scope management, keywords used and predictive versus agile life cycle. In this video, I'm going to explain you about the first process, that is planned scope management process, which falls under planning process group in more detail. That is about its inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. Planned scope management defined as the process of creating a scope management plan that documents how the project and product scope will be defined, validated and controlled. So it provides a guidance and direction on how the scope will be managed throughout the project. So in general, if I explain, we can define as it acts like an instructor who guides and gives direction to the project for how the scope will be managed during the course of the project. Hope you understand the definition of the plan's scope management. Okay, let's start with the ITTOS. That means inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. So the key inputs for this process are the project charter, the project life cycle and OPS, that is organizational process assets. The project charter. What is project charter? The project charter includes a high level description of the project, service or result, where the project life cycle breaks the project into different phases that will go to produce the service or result, the product. Here we can use the old project history records also, or lessons learned for planning efforts. So in addition to these inputs, every project has a development approach that could be a plan driven, that is predictive or waterfall model, and change driven, agile or adaptive or iterative, or combination of both, that is a hybrid. So already explained you about this, the development approaches, in my previous video. So let's discuss on tools and techniques of this plan scope management process. That is, we have expert judgment, data analysis and meetings. What is expert judgment? Expert judgment means, as you know, inputs will be collected from all the individuals or a group of people with specialized training and knowledge. Whereas the data analysis is collecting the requirements from different ways and elaborating the project and product scope. It means that we are using different alternate methods for collecting the requirements. Hope you understand the two, the expert judgment, data analysis. Now, and the last tool and technique is meeting, which is very important technique in all the project management processes, that includes discussion with all the stakeholders. That means the project manager, the project sponsor, selected project team members, selected stakeholders, or anyone who directly or indirectly involved in this project will gather and come to a conclusion on the meetings. So this is very important technique which you will come across in PM Box 6 many times in all the different processes. So let's discuss on the key points for this process. Key outputs. That is, we have two key outputs this process, that is scope management plan and the request management plan. Only this process will produce two outputs which are important for the scope. First, with the scope management plan. What is scope management plan? In this, the scope will be planned in three parts: planned, executed and controlled. Once the scope management plan is completed, it becomes part of the project management plan, and the project manager has the right and guides the project until it closes. So it is a good practice that once a product and project scope is defined, then only we have to start working on the project. Hope you understand the importance of the scope management plan. The second output is requirement management plan. This plan also refers to a business analysis plan. That means this plan explains us that describes a method to use identify the requirements, and also once we have all the requirements in place, it decides what has to be done to analyze, manage and track the changes, inclusions or exclusions, that all will be clarified in this document. So these two outputs, scope management plan, requirements management plan, are the parts of the project management plan. So hope you understand the important outputs, the scope management plan and the requirements management plan. Let's move to the next discussion, for which I've already explained you the difference between the product and the project scope in my last session. That is the work performed to deliver a product, service or result with the specified features and functions is a project scope. Whereas the features and functions that categorized a product is product scope. So hope you now clearly understand. We have another example, that is the game development lifecycle, in which stages of the game project management refers to the product scope, and also the characteristics of the product refers to the product scope. So that's all. So we have completed the first process in project management, that is plan scope management. So let's move to the next process in the next video, that is collect requirements. Thanks for watching this video. Kindly provide your feedback to the given email ID, and please subscribe my channel and encourage. Bye for now. We'll again meet in the next video, collect requirements in scope management. As continuing with the previous video, where I have explained you the first process in scope management, that is planned scope management. In this video, I'm going to explain you about the second process, collect requirements, which falls under the planning process group in more detail. And we are going to discuss about its inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. Okay, let's start with the process, collect requirements. This is the second process in planning process group. How this process is defined? It's defined as the process of determining, documenting and managing the stakeholder needs and requirements to meet the business objectives. It's a simple definition. In this process, we can explain as what are requirements. Requirements are what stakeholders need from a product or project. Hope you understand now what is requirements. And this process is very critical to the project success. If we miss any requirements which links with any significant changes or conflicts with other stages, that leads to the project failures also. So we have to be more alert in gathering the requirements. And also in this process, the project manager needs to choose different techniques to gather the requirements that are most appropriate for the project and the stakeholders. So this collected requirement should relate to the solving problems or achieving the objectives outlined in the project charter. And also this requirements can also relate to the quality, business process, compliance and project management. Let's give a small example. If quality of the product requested have some specific business process to send the reports, we need to compile with three standards and need to follow their project management internal process. So this is about the collect requirements process specifications. Let's move to the ITTIOs, that is inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. For starting with inputs, we have project charter, project management plan, which includes the scope management plan, requirement management plan and stakeholder engagement plan, and project documents, which includes assumption log, lessons learned register, stakeholder register, and the business documents, which includes business case, and we have agreements, and at last EEFs and OPS, that is enterprise environmental factors and organizational process assets. Moving to the tools and techniques, which includes expert judgment, And in data gathering, which includes the brainstorming, interviews, focus groups, questionnaires and surveys, benchmarking, and about data analysis, which includes document analysis, and moving to decision making, which includes voting and multi-criteria decision analysis. And we have data representation tools and techniques also, which includes affinity diagrams, mind maps diagrams. And we have interpersonal skills, which includes nominal group techniques and observations. So apart from this, we have other tools and techniques, that is context diagrams and prototypes. And we have outputs for this process are the requirements documentation and requirements traceability matrix, we will call as RTM. So you already knew about the project charter, which we have already discussed, that is the high level document, the stakeholder register, which contains the information of all the people who are involved in the project, and agreements are the documents between the two parties, and EFs and OPFs, as already you know. So these are the inputs. So moving to the tools and techniques, let's discuss more detail on the tools and techniques. First with brainstorming. What is brainstorming? The purpose of brainstorming is not so much to get individuals to share their thoughts on a topic, as it is to encourage participants to build on each other ideas. So it's a simple way to gather all the ideas. So next tool is the interviews, which can take place between the two individuals or in group settings, or can be done via the phone or virtual collaboration tools to collect the requirements. So this can also be referred as expert interviews. So moving to the next tools and techniques, that is focus groups. What are focus groups? These are a set of stakeholders or SMEs, that is subject matter experts, that can provide actual scope directed by a moderator. So this is a simple way, that is our focus groups. And moving to the questionnaires and surveys, these are typically used for larger groups to draw out the requirements from the respondents. We have another tool and technique, that is benchmarking. That is benchmarking, it focuses on measuring an organizational performance against that of other organizations in the same industry. That is the competition between the companies or the performance in the same industry. This tool is very costly and time consuming one, benchmarking. Moving to the next tool and technique, that is voting. We already know about the voting, but voting is commonly used to make decision in group settings. Hope you understand in simple way. That is, it is used to make decisions in group settings. We have four types of voting methods: unanimously, autocratic, majority, and plurality. Let's discuss on these four things. If the group agrees on a requirement, the complete group agrees, it's unanimously, that is everyone agrees, the decision is easy. If the decision making process is also simplified, if a single person is assigned to make the decision for the entire group, this is called autocratic method of decision making. It can have a negative impact also on the project if the stakeholders does not buy into single decision. Next, moving to the next one, when there are conflicting opinions, groups may also take a majority approach. If there is no majority opinion, the group may go with the decision that has the largest number of supporters, that is known as plurality. So we have covered these four types of voting methods. So moving to the next tools and technique, that is affinity diagrams. This is one important. So in this technique, the ideas generated from any other requirements gathering technique are grouped by similarities. So that is, each group of requirements is then given a title. This sorting makes it easier to see additional areas of scope that have not been identified. Hope you understand what are affinity diagrams. Affinity diagrams can also be organized by requirements categories, some common used when collecting requirements. That is, we have the business requirements, stakeholder requirements, solution requirements, transition requirements, and the project requirements. So here the example in this slide, let's you can easily understand with this slide. So let's moving to the technique, the mind maps. This is also an important one. Mind maps, it's a diagram of ideas are nodes to help generate, classify, or record information. It just looks like several trees branching out of a central core word of words. Colors, pictures, and notations can be used to make the diagram more readable. Just a simple diagrammatic representation. Hope you understand about these two things, affinity diagrams and mind maps. Let's discuss on the interpersonal and team skills technique, which includes here the nominal group technique, in which a question is posted, all the meeting participants write down and share their ideas. The group discussed what has been shared, and then ideas are ranked based on which ideas are most useful. So it is a, hope you clearly understand this nominal group technique. It's a group decision making. So moving to the next interpersonal and team skills technique is facilitated workshops. Here, the stakeholders can develop user stories as part of the workshops, that is specific requirements. We have two types of these tools we are using in these things. Joint application design, that is JAD, and the quality functional deployment, that is QFD. So apart from these tools and techniques, we have another next observation technique, which is similar to the kind of job scheduling one. So moving to the next technique which we are going to discuss is multi-criteria decision analysis. This is in which it used a decision matrix based on some factors such as expected risk levels, time estimates, cost benefits estimates. So hope you understand the multi-criteria decision analysis. So coming to the next technique is context diagrams. This is also an important one. It shows the boundaries of the product scope by highlighting the product and its interfaces with the people, process, systems. It's a context level data flow diagram. Okay, we can easily explain this as an it's a context level data flow of diagram. So moving to the next technique, we have prototypes. Is a model of the proposed product that is presented to stakeholders for feedback. It's kind of the proposed product is already existing one. We are using the same kind of things. Apart from this, we have to make sure that a stakeholder requests to do or add something to the project that is not related to the reason of the project was initiated. Our requirement is related to the reason, but it does not fall under the project charter. That summon should be rejected, what I mean. So, and also one more important point to note, any suggested changes to the project charter must be brought to the sponsor for approval. This is an mandated one. And next to the important concept is, delaying the schedule will not likely be accepted, and for enhancing the schedule will morally likely be accepted. These are the three points which we need to keep in mind. Okay, let's move to the outputs here. We have three main outputs. We have first requirement documentation. That is, we will discuss what is requirement documentation. Requirement documentation can contain various types of information, but one thing that must be included is acceptance criteria. This is an important one. Acceptance criteria has to be included in the requirement documentation. And moving to the last output, that is RDM, requirements disability matrix. This matrix helps link requirements to the objectives and requirements to ensure the strategic goals are accomplished. So this is the last output of the collect requirements. So we have covered the inputs, tools and techniques, and outputs. So we have completed the second process in the project scope management, that is collect requirements. So let's move to the next process, define scope, in the next video. Thanks for watching this video. Kindly provide your feedback to the given email ID, and please subscribe to my channel and encourage. Bye for now.
Welcome friends, I'm Anil Kumar Dharam, explaining you the defined process in scope management knowledge area in this video. As continuing with the previous video, where I have explained you the second process in scope management, that is collecting the requirements. In this video, I'm going to explain you about the defined process. Defined scope process, which falls under the planning process group, and about its inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. Okay, let's start.
defined process which falls under the planning process group. The key benefit of this process is that it describes the product, service, or result boundaries and acceptance criteria. Let's discuss about the inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. Inputs: the project charter, the project management plan, which includes the scope management plan, the project documents, which includes the assumption log, requirements documentation and risk register. And we have EEFs and OPAs, that is enterprise environmental factors, organizational process assets. Moving to the tools and techniques, we have expert judgment, data analysis, which includes alternative analysis, decision making, that is multi-criteria decision analysis, interpersonal and team skills, that is facilitation. And we have product analysis. Moving to the outputs, we have the project scope statement, the project documents updates, which includes assumption log, requirements documentation. And we have RTM, requirements traceability matrix, and the stakeholder register. These are the inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. Let's discuss these inputs, tools and techniques in more detail. Inputs we have already covered in the last video, which the project charter, the scope management plan, the project documents and the acceptance criteria. Moving to the tools and techniques, expert judgment we have already discussed, and moving to the product analysis, it's the product analysis purpose is to analyze the objectives and description of the product stated by the customer or sponsor and turn them into the tangible deliverables. Hope you understand about the product analysis. Coming to the, it's a critical tool. I will give you in more detail about this product analysis. It's a critical tool that allows the project manager to make sure that the project and product scope are understood and accurate. Hope you know, clearly understand about the product analysis. Moving to, if we discuss in more detail about this process, if a process uses this information from the project charter, scope management plan or the requirement documentation created in collector requirements process, assumption log and the risk creations to define the product and process scope. So it is clear now. So once the scope is defined, the project manager has to determine the schedule and budget. If this schedule and budget not meets with the sponsor or management expectations, the project manager has to revisit the scope and adjust according to meet the objectives. So this is the main concept of defining the scope process. Moving to the last, the outputs of this process are the project scope statement. We have project documents and RTM in the stakeholder register. We will discuss about the project scope statement first. Is the approved project and product or service go for this project? Once it is approved by all the parties, it will be called as the project scope statement. In the project scope statement, the project manager has to make sure that only the approved scope is defined and remove all the unapproved scope of work. This is the key point for the project manager in this project scope statement. And it also contains the product scope description, deliverables, acceptance criteria, project exclusions and constraints. Okay, we are already highlighted as this one, the project scope statement, work bin structure and the work branch dictionary compromises the scope baseline. So which, if we include these three things, project scope statement, WS and WS dictionary, we'll call as the scope baseline, which is part of the project management plan. So we have discussed about the key output of this process, and at last we have the project documents, which includes the assumption logs, the requirement documentation, requirements traceability matrix and the stakeholder register, which you are already having idea on this, what is assumption log and RTM and the requirement documentation. So it's complete, the inputs, outputs and the tools and techniques. So we have completed the defined scope process in the project scope management. So in the next video, we are going to discuss about the creating the work background structure. So hope you understand. It's a short video for the defining the scope. The key thing is the output, the scope, project scope statement. Thanks for watching this video. Kindly provide your feedback. to the given email ID. If you have any questions, send an email or provide your feedback on this video, and please subscribe my channel and encourage. Thank you.
Come friends, I'm Anil Kumar Dharam, explaining you the create work bin structure process in scope management knowledge area in this video. As continuing with the previous video, where I have explained you about the defined scope process in scope management. In this video, I'm going to explain you about the create work bin structure process, which is under the planning process group, in more detail. That is about its inputs, tools and techniques, and outputs. First, we have to understand what is work bin structure, that is WBS. A list of activities arranged by you with an hierarchy diagram, which shows the flow of all the activities and provide all the deliverables, is work breakdown structure. That is a graphical picture of the hierarchy of the project. WBS is always the foundation of the project, should exist for every project, and it is reusable for the other projects also. Hope you understand now. And also, work bin structure graphically provides a structure vision of a project and helps to ensure that nothing slips through the cracks and no deliverables are forgotten. I will explain in general. I can say by this hierarchy and graphical representation, it will be easily manageable, and by this sequence structure, we can easily find out what to do first and last. Hope you understand now what is WBS and why it is used. Okay, moving to the next concept, how this WBS created and its process flow. Let me explain in detail. Involving the team and stakeholders in creating a WBS helps and gain buy-in and increase the buy-in leads to improve the performance, and involving these two partners will have a better understanding of the project by this, and also understand how each work packages relates to other. That is, this WBS created by the project manager with the involvement and the input from both the team and the stakeholders. And also during the planning, the project management team and the SMEs, that is the subject matter experts, break down the scope description until the work package level is reached. That is the end of the work package, last stage of the work package. Let me explain this work package also. What is work package? The creation of the WBS is an effort to decompose the deliverables into smaller pieces that are called the work packages. Hope you understand what is work package now. And also note, as in a WBS, work is not an activity. It is a work product or deliverables that results from an activity or group of activities. Make sure you remember, in a project management, task is referred to an activity. We should call as project activities rather than the project task. So keep this note. And also, the task is a smaller component of work that make up the activity. So we have covered what is WBS, its creation and process flow. So finally, we can conclude as the work bin structure is the process of subdividing the project deliverables and project work into smaller and more manageable components. Hope it is very clear now about the WBS. Let's go with the ITTOs, that is inputs, output, tools and techniques, in more detail. First, moving to inputs, we have project management, which includes the scope management plan, project documents, which includes the project scope statement and requirements documentation, and we have EAFs and OPAs. And moving to the tools and techniques, we have expert judgment and decomposition. And about outputs, we have scope baseline and the project documents updates, which includes the assumption log and requirements documentation. So before going to in more detail of each, let me explain what is a control account. This is an important concept here. In a work breakdown structure, control accounts are assigned with respect to the work packages. Each work package in the WBS is assigned to only one control account. That is, control account is a tool that allows for the aggregation and analysis of the work performance data regarding cost, schedule and scope. We can call them as planning packages also. In other words, we can call as a control account is a management control point
at which the budgets and the actual cost are accumulated and compared to the earned value. Hope you understand about this. Let's move to the few other uses of WBS. The first important use of the WBS is it helps identifying the risk, helps prevent the changes, facilitates the communication cooperation between the project team and among the other stakeholders, help people to understand the projects. The second important use of WBS is on smaller projects, this WBS break down into the packages, that is work packages, that involves 4 to 40 hours. On medium, it is minus 8 to 80 hours. On our large projects, approximately 300 hours. So that is on the big projects, it does not only see the value of the information provided in the WBS, but they recognize the value of the efforts involving in creating the WBS adds to the project. So this is a second use, important use. Moving to the third key use is WBS from one project can be used as the basis for the other project. And at last use is when WBS is created, we can use it as a communication tool when there is any scope related change to the project. We can refer WBS and project scope document, check whether it fits within the project or it is out of the scope. That is, it gives the impact of any other changes occurred. So we have better understanding the use of the WBS in different scenarios. Let's discuss on what is WBS dictionary and scope baseline. First with WBS dictionary. It prevents a scope creep before even work starts on the project. That is, a WBS dictionary can include the description of the schedule milestones, acceptance criteria, durations, interdependencies, and other information about the work packages. That is WBS dictionary. Moving to the scope baseline. With this, the project manager controls over the project and make note of this. Scope baseline is made up of final versions of WBS, WBS dictionary, and the project scope statement that are approved at the end of the planning before the project work begins. Okay, fine. So we have covered the important concepts in this process, that is WBS, WBS dictionary, and the scope baseline. Let's discuss on the inputs, outputs, and tools and techniques. Coming to the inputs, scope management plan, project scope statement, requirement documentation, which we have already had a discussion in the previous processes. Let's concentrate on the tools and techniques. We have expert judgment and decomposition tools in this. First, expert judgment. We already know that it's a discussion of all the experts with a specific knowledge on the subject. And let's move to the decomposition. What is decomposition? It is a technique used for dividing and subdividing the project scope and project deliverables into smaller, more manageable parts. This decomposition identifies and analyzing the deliverables and related to the work. It structure and organizing the WBS, decomposition the upper WBS levels into lower level detail components. It develops and assigning the identification codes to the WBS components, and also it verifies that the degree of decomposition of the deliverables is appropriate. So, and also we have two approaches in this for decomposition. We have a top-down approach and a bottom-up approach. So we have to make note as important note on this decomposition. On excessive decomposition can lead to a non-productive management effort, that is insufficient use of resources, decreased efficiency in performing the work, and difficulty in aggregating the data over different levels of the WBS. And also, decomposition may not be possible for a deliverable or subcomponent that will be accomplished far into the future. We have another thing, is 100% rule. What is 100% rule? The total of the work at the lowest level should roll up to the higher level so that nothing is left out and no extra work is performed. That is the 100% rule. So everything is covered from the lower level to the upper level. See an example of partial WBS. That is, in which you can see the slide, in which a project is divided into more manageable sections, that is planning, defining and design, execute, optimize and release, and this activity is again divided into other activities until end of the workbench structure, which refers to the end, that is work packages. Hope you understand now. We have another an example in the next slide, that is WBS created by deliverables and project phases. Deliverables example, construction of a house with different rooms, alignments, etc. with phases. Planning, design, build, inspection and close. Okay, so we have better understanding on decomposition and other key things. Let's move to the outputs of this process. That is scope baseline and the project documents, which includes assumption log and requirement documentation. What is scope baseline? We already had a discussion on this. Project manager controls over the project by using the scope baselines. And scope baseline is made up of final versions of the WBS, WBS dictionary and the project scope statement that are approved at the end of the planning before the project work begins. So we understand what is project scope statement, WBS. Now let me explain what is WBS dictionary. WBS dictionary is a document that provides detailed deliverable activity and scheduling information about each component that is in the WBS. Hope you understand now. It includes what it contains, a WBS dictionary. It contains the code of account identifier, description of the work, assumption and constraints, responsible organization, schedule milestones, resource required, and acceptance criteria. And at last, we have the project document updates output, which includes assumption log, requirement documentation, which we have already covered. Hope this session provides you more details on the work breakdown structure. Keep note of all these important points which I have discussed, which will be important for your examination and understanding on this concept. So we have completed the create WBS process in project scope document. So let's move to the next process. Thanks for watching this video. If you like this video, kindly provide your feedback to the given email ID on the slide and please subscribe my channel and encourage. Bye for now. Welcome friends, I'm Anil Kumar Dharam, explaining you the validate scope process in scope management knowledge area in this video. As continuing with the previous video, where I explained you about creating the work bench structure process in scope management. In this video, I'm going to explain you about the validate scope process, which is under monitoring and controlling process group in more detail, that is about its inputs, tools and techniques and outputs. Let's start with the process definition. Validate scope. What is validate scope? This process actually involves frequent plan meetings with the customer or sponsor to gain the formal acceptance of the deliverables during the project monitoring and controlling. That is the process of formalizing the acceptance of the completed project deliverables. When you meet the customer to validate the scope, verify deliverables, scope baseline, requirement traceability matrix, that is RTM, requirements documentation, scope management plan, work performance data. This all need to be ready, and also we have to be ensured that the project is on track from the customer point of view. So this is a simple way to define the validate scope. Let's move to the inputs, output, tools and techniques, ITTOs. Inputs. We have project management plan, which includes the scope management plan, requirement management plan, scope baseline. And we have project documents, which includes lessons learned register, quality reports, and we have requirement documentation, RTM, that is requirement traceability matrix, verify deliverables, work performance data. And coming to tools and techniques, we have inspection and decision making. And about outputs, we have accepted deliverables, work performance information, change request, project documents, that includes the lessons learned registered and the requirement documentation and the RTM. Let me explain more in detail about each input, tools and techniques and outputs. Inputs. We have project management plan, which includes the scope management plan and the requirements management plan and the scope baseline. Let me explain first about the scope management plan, which shows the previously agreed upon deliverables and plans for gaining the formal acceptance for them. You will also need to share information about the requirements of the project and show the customer how those requirements have been validated. This information can be found in the requirements management plan and the RTM. And the work must be completed and checked before each meeting with the customer. Therefore, you must have the verified deliverables from the control quality process. It is helpful to have the approved scope with you when you meet the customer. So you need the scope baseline from the project management plan. In addition, you should have the requirement documentation with you in order to compare the requirements to the actual results. You can determine whether any action or change need to be take place. So the project documents such as the quality reports and the lessons learned register should also be reviewed at this start of this process. We need to refer the work performance data from the direct and managed project work to assess how well product deliverables are meeting the requirements. We also need to share the information about the requirements of the project and show the customer how those requirements have been validated. So this information can be found in the requirements management plan and the RTM. So we have covered the inputs for validation scope. Let's move to the tools and techniques for this process, which includes inspection and the decision making. That decision making includes the voting part. Inspection. Activities such as measuring, examining, and validating the deliverables against the requirements and the product acceptance criteria, that is for the inspection. And we have the product reviews, walkthroughs, and all some examples of inspections. Coming to decision making, which includes the voting part. You know, the voting is used to reach a conclusion when the validation is performed by the project team members and the other stakeholders. So we have covered the tools and techniques, that is inspection and the decision making. At last, moving to the outputs of this process, we have accepted deliverables, work performance information, change request, and the project document updates. Explaining the outputs in various aspects of the validate scope. First, it can be done at the end of the each project phase in the project life cycle. You had to get the formal acceptance of the phase deliverables along the way. Make a note of this point as we have to validate the scope with the customer multiple times throughout the project. So in a change driven project also, this will happen at the end of each iteration as the part of iteration review with the customer, whereas validation scope results in formal acceptance by the customer, that is for the intermediate deliverables. And also it's part of the reason for close project or phase process is to get the final acceptance or sign off from the customer for this project. So you better understand about this outputs, the accepted deliverables, work performance information, and the change request and the project document updates. So we have covered the inputs, output, tools and techniques for the validation scope in the scope management. Keep note of all these important points to your examination and understanding. So we have completed the validate scope process in the project scope management. So let's move to the next process, control scope process, in the coming video. Thanks for watching this video. Kindly provide your feedback to the given email ID and please subscribe my channel and encourage. Thanks and bye for now. Welcome friends, I'm Anil Kumar Dharam explaining you about the control process in scope management knowledge area in this video. As continuing with the previous video where I have explained you about the validate scope process in the scope management, in this video I'm going to explain you about the control scope process, which is falls under the monitoring and controlling process group, in more detail. That is about its inputs, tools and techniques, and outputs. Let's start with our topic today. Many managers do not really control the projects because of some gaps in their knowledge of this process. So we have to make clear about this process, because this control scope involves measuring and assessing the work performance data against the scope baseline and mapping the scope baseline changes. So we have to remember that this process is extremely proactive, which includes thinking about the changes to the scope are coming from on the project, or what can be done to prevent or remove the need of any more changes from the source. Moreover, if we use these project management tools, techniques and practices, will save you from unnecessary problems throughout the life of the project. And also, a project manager's job is not just to process other changes, but it controls the project to the project management plan and meets all the baselines. Okay, let's move to the ITTOs, that is inputs, tools and techniques, and outputs for the control scope. In the inputs, we have project management plan, project documents, work performance data, and OPA, in which the project management plan includes scope management plan, requirement management plan, change management plan, configuration management plan, scope baseline, and performance measurement baseline. And the project documents, which includes lessons learned register, requirement documentation, requirement traceability matrix, that is RTM. And in the tools and techniques, we have data analysis, that is, we have variance analysis and trend analysis. And coming to the outputs, we have work performance data, change request, project management plan updates, project document updates. Project management plan updates, which includes scope management plan, scope baseline, schedule baseline, cost baseline, and performance baseline. And also we have the project document updates, which includes lessons learned register, RTM, and the requirement documentation. So these are all the attitudes for the control scope. Let's discuss its inputs in more detail one by one. First, with the project management plan, which includes the scope management plan, documents how the project and product scope will be controlled. And the requirements management plan, which describes how the project requirements will be managed. And change management plan, which defines the process of managing the change on the project. And about the configuration management plan, which defines those items that are configurable, those items are required formal change control, and the process for controlling the changes to such items. So this is the configuration management plan. And moving to the scope baseline, which is compared to the actual results to determine if a change, corrective action, or preventive action is necessary when using earned value analysis. And at last, we have the performance measurement baseline, which is compared to the actual results to determine if a change, corrective action, or preventive action is also necessary. These are the project management plan inputs. We have project documents, work performance data, and OPS. In project documents, we have lessons learned register, that is, the lessons earlier in the project, that is starting of the project or initial stage, can apply to the later phases in the project to improve the scope control. We have requirements documentation also, which is used to detect any deviation in the agreed upon scope for the project or product. And at last, we have RTM, that is requirement traceability matrix, which helps to detect the impact of any change or deviation from the scope baseline on the project objectives. So these are for the project document inputs. We have work performance data. What is work performance data? It includes the number of changes received, the number of requests accepted, and the number of deliverables verified and validated and completed. So this is the work performance data. And we have last input is OPAs, organizational process assets, includes existing formal and informal scope, control related policies, or guidelines or templates for monitoring and reporting methods. So we have covered the inputs. Let's move to the tools and techniques. We have data analysis, which includes the variance analysis and the trend analysis. What is variance analysis? Variance analysis is used to compare the baseline to the actual results and determine if the variance is within the threshold amount, correct, or if preventive action is appropriate. So we understand what is variance analysis. Let's move to trend analysis. Trend analysis, it examines the project performance over time to determine if performance is improving or decreasing. So it gives some kind of trend for increase or decrease. So this is about the tools and techniques. Let's move to the outputs of this process. We have work performance information, change request, project management plan updates, project document up. First, with work performance information, which includes correlated and contextualized the information on how the project and product scope are performing with respect to the scope baseline. It also includes the baselines or other components of the project management plan. It can be processes through performance integrated change control. That is the change control process. And last, we have project management plan updates and project document updates as other outputs. Project management plan updates, which includes, as you know, the scope management plan, scope baseline, schedule baseline, cost baseline, performance measurement baseline, and the project documents, which includes lessons learned register, requirements documentation, requirement traceability matrix. So these are all the outputs of the control scope. So we have covered the inputs, outputs, tools, and techniques for the control scope in the scope management. K
keep note of all important points to your examination and understanding. So we have completed the control scope process in the project scope management. So it means that we have completed the last process in scope management. Congratulations. And in the next chapter, I'm going to discuss on the schedule management knowledge area in more detail. Thank you guys for watching this video. Kindly provide your feedback to the given email ID, which is available on the slide. And please subscribe my channel and encourage. Thank you.